very much for the presentations today. Just very briefly, in terms of setting the context for everybody in the audience here, if you could just give a very brief contextualization and background of what your role is and what you do, that would be great. So, Elizabeth?
At Visa, I'm responsible for our digital efforts, our information products, our version of big data, our processing products, and our merchant and acquirer relations all globally.
Okay, so I'm leading the department within China about dealing with all the services we provide through cell phones other than voice. So basically we do all the value-added services in our department, like big data, like mobile video, mobile reading, mobile payments, mobile gaming, SNS, email, all kind of stuff. So that's our department.
So my role of emerging business is a bit of a weird one. I have a 23-year-long life sentence so far at Rogers. And the objective is to push the organization into do unusual things. And so the last 13 years, it's been increasingly financial services related. But prior to that, you know, I pushed the organization into, say, machine-to-machine, you know, type of services, so non-human interfaces. And so just like last week, I think we passed 1 million machines on our network. So we have about 10 million wireless customers and now 1 million machines, which, you know, 13 years ago was just a bizarre concept. Well, I hope that mobile payments and financial service from operators will be not unusual 10 years from now.
Okay, and just to set the context from my side, my name's Neil. I head up wireless devices research globally at Strategy Analytics. So I thought, let me dive in with a question here to kick things off. And I thought your presentation was especially good, Elizabeth. I thought you made some good comments about NFC and also some of the competitive environments that are out there. Could you give a feel for, I think it's important to understand the competitive environment, and could you give a feel for what other technologies you think are out there that are competing with NFC? What are some of the alternatives to that technology at the moment, and in which regions of the world you're seeing?
Well, I think sort of from a payment perspective, everything competes with NFC, right? The reason that in this market it's been so difficult for NFC to take off is the question of what problem are you solving, right? We have a really well-deployed, highly efficient, effective, mutually understood payment market. So to overcome that, the retraining, the cost of deployment of both the payment device and the acceptance device has been a very high hill to climb. But where you've seen what has made NFC attractive is the innovation. I mean, exactly as David said, it's not the fact that you can make a payment. We have lots of ways to do that. It's what more you can do to be able to make a payment. But here in this market, as I mentioned, QR codes, cloud technologies, because very often they require less infrastructure investment and less change, you've really seen a lot of innovation in that space. Outside the United States, where we have seen NFC take off most is in those markets that have well-deployed transit infrastructure or a domestic payment scheme. I could go on about this for a long time, but that's the kind of common element of why Hong Kong, Singapore, Japan, et cetera. So we continue to see this as a horse race and will absolutely enable and promote NFC, but need to promote those other technologies as well.
Okay. That's a good point you make on QR codes there, I think. Mm-hmm. Mr. Liu in China, last time I was there, I seem to recall QR codes were getting a little bit of traction. Is that something you're seeing as well?
Sure, yeah. Just for QR code, we're actually seeing a lot of a population on the QR code because of the OTT companies. They are all promoting QR codes right now. Some of you may familiar with a company called Tencent. They provide the WeChat thing. It's about 500 million subscribers right now. They're starting to promote the QR-based payment through their client installed on smartphones. I think just a couple months, I think in August, they're starting to doing that. So I totally agree, it's a horse race right now, yeah. So from operators' perspective, we think that it's a it's not just a function, it's not just a payment we're providing, it's a platform that we can build on that to provide more. So, but if we don't move fast enough, I think we are losing the game, so.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very, very important to move quickly, and Tencent, for example, is moving very quickly in that
sure.
QR code yeah, space, yeah, right? Yeah. Okay. David, in Canada, is that something you're seeing, or is it still very much an NFC-dominated
world? No, you're like, we have Starbucks as well, right? So, Tim Hortons. And look, our approach is to try to present whatever the merchant accepts. And so, you know, the merchant acceptance of contactless is very evolved, as I explained, and so therefore we can play that role. But in the gift card space, if the merchant accepts a QR code or the merchant accepts a number, the SureTap wallet will distribute gift cards in such a way that they get presented in a way that the merchant accepts them. And so it comes down to acceptance more than the issuance side,
right, right.
side of things. And so we'll try to do the kind of the hard stuff because we can and we should and bring the contactless cards to the phones. But if we can do the QRs and the numeric codes, well, then we'll do that as well.
Okay. Mr. Liu, in your presentation, mm-hmm. I thought you made a great point about the level of technology fragmentation in China mm-hmm. for things like voice calls, for example. Mm-hmm. So you have TDS CDMA, mm-hmm. WCDMA, CDMA, there's a lot of fragmentation there. There's also an element of fragmentation, I think it's fair to say, in the NFC world globally as well.
Right.
So when we start to talk about things like NFC roaming and international payment roaming, moving from country to country and using your NFC phones in different territories. What kind of challenges do you see there and what kind of solutions would you recommend the industry start to look at?
Well, yeah, there are two things. That first, I think it's the handset itself. Second is the roaming kind of standards, like the loyalty cards, like the coupons. Those kind of information cannot be transferred in a standard way today through NFC. So I think ISIS, they have their own standards. Korea, Japan, they have their own. So we're actually, think we're working with the GSMA, try to push that a single standard so that people can use that to roaming in different countries. But the handsets, that's the, just I mentioned in my little presentation that today the manufacturers, they are actually implement NFC, but for different countries, they are implement not in the same way. So that make a quite difficulties for different operators to sell the cell phones to customers. So I think we as operators, we need probably work together to make those standards a unify so people can one day they can use one phone in different countries in the same way. So that's a key factors to make this thing work. So,
yeah, yeah. Okay. And the GSMA doing some initiatives?
Yes,
GSMA
have a used to call a fast track now. It's a different, but it's a mechanism to make a group of operators to make that thing work. So yeah,
okay.
We're part of that too, yeah.
David, any thoughts from your perspective on that?
Well, I'd agree. I mean, we've found all sorts of inconsistent interpretation of the standards.
Right.
That's what I've seen happening now. And I think this is normal in any early stage technology.
Yeah.
There are no standards until such time as everyone interprets the methodologies in exactly the same way. And so we'll find very strange things happening where we would make everything work just fine on a particular version of a particular manufacturer's device, and then you would think that the next version would of course work when you receive it, and so far we haven't found that. So even from one version to another, as you move forward, we're getting slightly different interpretations of the standards, which is causing a lot of heartache. And so yeah, it does come down to carriers, at least regionally, certainly inside Canada and hopefully inclusive of the United States, to be able to say, hey, we need these devices to interpret these standards in exactly the same way so
yes.
that we receive them and they work. We're just not there yet.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Elizabeth, I thought you made a very good point as well about the fragmentation in the plastic credit card and debit card industry. Some regions using magnetic stripes and others using chip and pin and so forth. Any lessons from that world that you think we should translate over into the NFC mobile money world?
Well, I think it's right. The theme here is standards. And in fact, David and I were talking before about the fact that not only do you have chip and pin and mag stripe and signature, you have chip and signature in Asia, and increasingly signature isn't required with a particular kind of access device. But why do all of those things work? When I take my Singapore-issued credit card and I use it here in the United States, it works because there is a standard and there's agreement among the participants in the network on exactly how those transactions are going to be treated, what are the rights and responsibilities, and that's what really makes a global network, and that's where we have to struggle, to David's point about the hard road, we have to struggle to get if we're going to have, we accommodate the fragmentation but still have operation globally.
Yeah. So have key standards to work around, make sure we're all kind of rowing in the same direction, as it were.
And I would just add another plug for the GSMA. I mean, the challenge is, how do we all get together and say, let's agree standards? And that's what puts the GSMA in such an important and special position.
Yeah, totally agree. So on the operator side then, David, I thought you made some good notes about how there has to be an ecosystem and how everybody has to cooperate. Do you think any operators will try to go it alone, or do you think they should all partner? Should any operators try to do it themselves, or would that be foolish?
Yeah, I forget how many carriers there are globally, but I think GSM Association has, 800 members or something like that. It's actually fairly fragmented, so the thought of an individual carrier in any market kind of going at it alone, I think when the standards are truly standard and you can buy a device, you can get things off the shelf and they actually work, you know, maybe that will be possible one day. But I'd say right now, where we're still at the early stages, I think cooperation between carriers, certainly regionally and inclusive of probably certain other partners, is fairly fundamental to get us to a level where it can scale massively, because it's got to be a massive scale game, and that's what carriers do. Right. The same thing really well over and over and over and over again. And if it's fragments, it's difficult to do that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mr. Liu, any thoughts from your side?
Sure. Yeah, I totally agree with David on that part. Especially on an early stage, we need to collaborate together to make that thing. Otherwise, the whole value chain will not move in the same way. Yeah. Will definitely kill this thing, I think. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Elizabeth, any thoughts from your side?
Other than to agree now.
Yeah. I think my sense from my side is that, you know, carriers should partner, and there does need to be this collaboration, coexistence, cooperation, etc. But operators always like to kind of try to build their own ecosystem. So I think some operators may try to go it alone and may not cooperate quite as much as they should do. So I think there will be some standalone players out there. I won't mention them alive, but I do think there will be some.
Could I add a bit to that? Because I think we're sort of, the reality is many of us are for-profit companies, right? So we have an obligation to our owners, to our shareholders, to make a profit. And so as we are joining hands and singing songs of solidarity and adopting standards, we have to be sure that there is room for us to differentiate. And to your point, Neil, if a carrier or any provider in the ecosystem is sufficiently large, that entity could say, I have a story to tell my owners and investors if I go it alone, and it's less clear that I have the business model in participation for doing that. So I think that's part of our responsibility as well, to give each of us individually the business model and return story at the same time that we are laying the groundwork that, as David said, allows us to scale massively.
Mm-hmm. Totally agree, Elizabeth, totally agree. All right, so final couple of questions then, I think, of this session. For Elizabeth, I think I'd like to direct this one at you to begin with. The secure element for NFC phones, for NFC devices, absolutely critical in terms of ownership of where it sits. Any thoughts on whether it should sit in the phone, in the SIM card, or elsewhere? Any thoughts on where that might be headed in 2014?
You know, I think I'm glad I'm answering first, because I have the least useful answer, because from our business's perspective, we must be technology and device agnostic. I mean, we came out in the past year with something called the Visa Ready service that made it easier for us to test and certify devices of all types, applications of all types, because it's not up to us to pick a winner. So I would defer to my colleagues on the panel for their view on that.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Mr. Liu, where would you like to see the secure element sitting?
Well, yeah, just like the, we actually, for China Mobile, we actually try out, you know, different approaches. For the early stage, I think like a couple of years back, we did try the security elements on the handsets mm-hmm. solution, which is the full handset solutions. But now we, as I mentioned, we are already commit to the SWP model, which the security element will be on the same cards. So that's a great opportunity for us to work with other operators, especially through a GSMA mechanism. So, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Like I said, to me, this is a mass scale exercise. And the issue with the secure element location is not so much the religious debate about it, should it be on a micro SD, or should it be on the device, or should it be in the UICC? The problem is we can't support it as a carrier if it's anywhere else other than on the UICC. This is what we've done for decades, mm-hmm. distribute our credential, our phone number over the air and store it securely on a piece of memory, called the UICC or the SIM as an app. And so any other methodology is just something that we can't support, not because it can't be done, but because we can't have a completely different solution for this handset and that handset or the other. Mm-hmm. And our call centers and our support models just simply can't do that in massive scale. And yet we can do, you know, virtualization of credentials for third parties over the air to the same piece of secure memory that we've used ourselves for decades securely without any other issues. So it's simply a practical matter of how can you scale massively? And the answer is it's got to be in the same place that's worked for carriers for decades.
Yeah. Just to put on my analyst hat for a second, and analysts always love numbers. Mm-hmm. We estimate that the penetration of the secure element on handset shipments globally this year is probably going to be in the region of about a 50-50 split, more or less. So mm-hmm. it's still very much to be decided at the moment, and different stakeholders pulling in multiple directions still, I think, and that's still very much work in progress.
Yep.
So I'm conscious that we're bumping up against time, so let me just wrap up here and say that we've seen some excellent viewpoints from Visa and China Mobile and Rogers Wireless Canada. If you had to summarize in one line, one sentence, what would be your key message for everybody in the audience here for 2014? In order to make NFC phones, NFC devices, NFC ecosystems scale and take off, what would you recommend that people have to do next year to make sure this industry scales and takes off? So, David, did you want to go first on that one?
Sure. I think you just have to do it. You can't learn this and learn, you know, the how it works and how it doesn't work by reading about it. You simply have to immerse yourself to whatever degree you can and try to figure out how to make it work for your particular market. There's just nothing like trial and error.
Okay, so I think as I mentioned, the NFC is not just for payment only. It's a platform that can build on, not only for operators, but also for other partners across the industries. So everyone can get their own business models and applications based on NFC. So I think that's a big key issues for both carriers and also customers.
I think simply know what problem you're trying to solve for whom.
Okay. And I will add standards. I thought that was an excellent point made. So execution, collaboration, implementation, standards, they're the key things to do. With that, I thank you very much for your time. I believe there's a network break now, but please put your hands together and thank the panel for their excellent input.